about right now, controlling the line of scrimmage. All right, we wasn't gonna miss a beat. 173 yards front down. Yeah. Defense, talking about getting off the field on third down. They were 2 for 12.
Yeah. Hey, great job, defense. Y'all went out there and shut them down. Yeah. Offense, way to f***ing run the ball.
Yeah. This for you, brother. Yeah.
Fantasy Football Happy Hour with Matthew Berry, served by Applebee's.
That was the sound of a bunch of Panthers celebrating, keep pounding. That's what they kept doing against the Buccaneers, a 21-3 home victory for the Carolina Panthers in Steve Wilkes' debut.
21-3.
As the interim head coach of the Carolina Panthers. Congratulations to everyone in Carolina, including interim head coach Steve Wilkes, and of course, former XFL superstar, now NFL superstar, PJ Walker. It is the Fantasy Football Happy Hour served by Applebee's. It's noon on a Monday on Peacock, but of course, it's 5 o'clock somewhere, Jay Croucher. My name is Matthew Berry, and I think the only thing in this world more surprising than the Buccaneers getting their butts kicked by the Carolina Panthers, a Panthers team that has traded Robbie Anderson, has traded Christian McCaffrey, that appears to they fired their head coach. They're like, we're playing for next year.
Yeah.
We're tanking. They're the team in your dynasty league that's like, hey, we're tanking.
Yeah,
they sent out the email to the whole league, like, open for business. Like, it ain't our year. Everything must go. That team kicked Tom Brady's ass. Like, just destroyed the Tampa Bay Buccaneers up, down, sideways. And I think the only thing, Jay Croucher, more exciting, more surprising, more shocking than that, is this giant, insane apple that showed up on our set. We walked in this morning. I wish you guys, for those that are listening on the podcast, I wish you guys could see this thing, because it is literally the size. You know how, like, when the Mets hit a home run?
Yeah, I was going to say, it's like Jacob DeGrom kind of pulled this over here in his car this morning.
He might have. Listen, the Mets don't need it anymore. Let's be clear about that. Go Phillies. I mean, it's a massive apple. I don't know what happened with this, Jay. Listen, you're smart. Like, you're smart. You're a big fan of fine dining and everything like that. Does that apple? I can't imagine that Applebee's people are happy about this, right? You know, like, does that apple make you long for healthy casual dining with mainstream American dishes such as salads, chickens, pasta, burgers, and riblets? It does not.
Doesn't make you think of riblets?
No, it does not make me think of riblets. Like, we love Applebee's here. The whole show is served by Applebee's. It's your friendly neighborhood bar. But I just, I'm like, oh, look at that big giant neon apple.
Now listen.
I need a plate of riblets. That's not a phrase that anyone at home is saying, Jay Croucher. How did this get on our set?
It's great that we keep bringing up the riblets. Now, listen, you did turn around initially and say, where is the big apple? And then you went, or you used a different word, but you're like, oh, my God, there's the apple.
But now I can't unsee it. We have a Popeyes. we have a Popeyes pinball machine,
it's
and now
happening.
A big giant neon apple.
Right, that's the headline.
What's
apple.
Going on?
Let's get into some Roto World.
Maybe you know what it is.
Football.
Maybe it is. Maybe you know what it is. You know what it might be.
What is it?
It might be representing. It's a big apple, and it might be just representing the big apple.
Yeah.
Giants and Jets both win again yesterday. Massive games. If you live in New York and you're not a Mets fan, you're pretty happy here.
Or a Yankees.
Or a Yankees fan. That's a good point.
Yeah,
that's
it's a
good
football
point.
Town now.
It's a
I
football
was told,
town.
Coming from Australia, that New York is a baseball town. Apparently not.
How
Apparently
shocking is that,
town.
By the way, that, like, whatever, two months ago, if we'd said, like, by the way,
yeah.
you know, between the Yankees, Mets, the Jets, and Giants, they're going to be playing meaningful sports in late October. You know, which of the two teams do you think it will be?
It's going to be Zach Wilson and Daniel Jones.
Right, exactly. 6-1 Giants, 5-2 Jets, but, and the Mets and Yankees have been eliminated.
Unfortunately, though, one of the guys who's not going to be a part of that New York run going forward is Breece Hall.
This is awful.
And he headlines the notable Week 7 injuries. We'll come back to Breece because that's the big story. But the Sun God gets a concussion. Mike Williams does his ankle. DK Metcalf with a knee injury gets carted off. And then David Njoku with an ankle, which probably not as serious as the other injuries. But I think Breece Hall, here's the story.
So, yeah, Amon-Ra St. Brown, he's in the concussion protocol. We'll see what he is. Mike Williams, it's worth noting, Chargers on a bye next week, so we have some time there. He's got 2 weeks to get healthy, and as you mentioned, as we are broadcasting this at noon Eastern on Monday, we don't have any updates yet on David Njoku or DK Metcalf, but initial reports out of New York after the injury was they feared an ACL tear for Breece Hall, which would mean his season is over. We are obviously hoping for the best. We've not gotten official word yet on that. Maybe news will come here in the hour that we're together, Jay. But let's assume the worst. And this is awful, right? I mean, yeah. Breece Hall, a true star in the making. Both real life and in fantasy football, nothing short of amazing. I have two sort of takeaways here, and I want your reaction to it. First off, the obvious one is that whenever there's a devastating injury like this, it does create opportunity, and opportunity means fantasy success. So Michael Carter, who's available in 34% of Yahoo leagues, suddenly should see an uptick in work, right? He's had six career games where he's gotten 15 or more touches. He's averaging 17.9 fantasy points per game. He's had over 100 yards from scrimmage in four of those six games. So we'd expect a big workload here, especially because they continue to seem like they want to hide this offense. Like, yep. The whole Jets offense is Breece Hall. And that's my other concern here, is that Breece Hall's a special guy. And, like, they don't want to throw. They don't want Zach Wilson to throw. We joked about it on Fantasy Football pregame yesterday morning. Like, they're hiding Zach Wilson, not just from neighborhood moms.
Here we go.
Right? But also from, defenders in the secondary. Like, it is a conservative, highly conservative, run-centric offense that they got away with because Breece Hall is so good and their defense is playing well. Does this entire offense just go in the tank with no Breece Hall, Jay?
I think so. And I think, they looked so bad yesterday outside of Breece. And it's so sad that he has his iconic moment, his best moment of his career. He breaks the massive touchdown run, the Breece lightning run, and then he goes down soon after that. I wouldn't read too much into how much the offense struggled yesterday just because the Denver defense is one of the three or four best in the entire league.
1,000%.
And also, it's just difficult when you pivot your offense mid-game when your superstar goes down. So I do think Michael Carter will be more efficient going forward. Do you think this brings a bit of life maybe into Garrett Wilson, into other pass catchers on the Jets just because they're not going to be as Breece heavy?
I think it's going to have to, right? And so maybe Elijah Moore gets out of the doghouse. So they figure that out. Denzel Mims and Corey Davis both left this game with minor injuries. So we'll see if there's any severity to that as well. They play New England next week, which you don't. Well, I mean,
no,
Zach Wilson against Belichick is hashtag not ideal. Yep. Patriots will be traveling on a short week because they play tonight.
Patriots are favored in that game as well in New York. 2.5-point favorites, the Pats.
By the which is sort of crazy, by the way. And it goes to my, Anyway, so we'll see how tonight plays out for the Patriots as well. But this is just it just sucks. There's nothing. It sucks for football. It sucks for fantasy football. It sucks for Breece Hall and his many fans and family and the Jets. We feel terrible.
About 10 minutes before the injury, sportsbooks pulled the offensive rookie of the year market because Breece was so dominant that they pulled it, thinking that it was a foregone conclusion. And then 10 minutes later, he gets injured, which is terrible. But let's move on. I think the other injuries, it's largely a wait-and-see game. But it's no longer really a wait-and-see game on Tom Brady and the Tampa Bay offense,
dude,
which has just been bad consistently. They put up 3 points in basically garbage time against the Panthers. They do nothing. Now, this has been largely 3 weeks of this, where they scored 21 against Atlanta, 18 against Pittsburgh, 3 against Carolina. What's the alarm bell looking like on the Tampa Bay Buccaneers offense?
It's got to be pretty high here as we show a tweet from at NFL Research. With his Week 7 loss to the Panthers, Tom Brady has a losing record through his first 7 games of a season for the first time since 2002, which, of course, was his first full season as NFL starting quarterback and the only healthy season of his career in which he did not make the playoffs. Now, the positives are is that he's in the NFC South, which is just, a brutal division. So you can be mediocre and still wind up with the division record here. They play the Thursday night game against the Ravens this week. Here's the positives on Tom Brady. He's now thrown 42 or more pass attempts in four of the last five games. Like, the volume is still there. He still has elite pass catchers around him. We still like Chris Godwin. We still like Mike Evans quite a bit. We still like Leonard Fournette as a running back and a pass catching option out of the backfield. He's actually top eight in red zone pass attempts this season. So those are all the things we like. And I do think that, I mean, Mike Evans, like, if you want to see it here, for those of you watching on Peacock, you watch this, but just watch the, I mean, like, you're not going to see a more wide open drop than this one right here as Brady goes back to pass from his own 35-yard line. Mike Evans, clear as daylight, and just, oh, boy.
Comical.
Like, I mean, just, like, off of it. Like, Mike Evans, one of the best wide receivers in the NFL. Like, there's no one around for distance. Like, it just, it literally hits him in his hands.
It's always worse than, like, hit it forward and then try to chase
it. It is a perfect pass. It is, he just blows by. The defender is down, and then just right in the breadbasket. Like, it's one of those, it's just like, oh. And that would have been a 64-yard touchdown. And yeah. I think, and they said after the game, like, it just, the sort of ball went, air went out of the ball after that. The whole Buccaneers team just sort of got deflated. And I think the numbers obviously look different if there's a 64-yard touchdown pass to Tom Brady, who in this game, 49 pass attempts, 290 yards. And again, should have been like almost 350 with at least one touchdown. So I think the narrative around him is a little bit different. Coming into week seven here, and we'll see what happens tonight, right? But coming into week seven, the Baltimore Ravens were a middle-of-the-pack pass defense.
Yep.
They played better recently over the last 4 weeks, but, like, they're not the defense. They're not the Ravens of old.
No.
They don't scare you. Is Tom Brady a locked-in, set-and-forget-it QB1 anymore? Of course he isn't. I mean, like, how could he be, right? Under 15 fantasy points in 5 of 7 games, you know. But I do think, again, he's throwing a ton. He still looks like Brady. He's missed a few more throws than he normally would, but overall, he still looks like Tom Brady in terms of the accuracy. He's got a 2.7% touchdown rate, like, which is just career low for him. I think positive regression is coming for Tom Brady.
Yep. They're 1.5-point underdogs at home on BetMGM to the Ravens on Thursday night on the short week. So MGM is buying that there is something wrong with this Bucs team. I will say, though, I don't think the Panthers' defense is that bad. The Panthers might have an above-average defense. It's the offense where there are typically issues, though not really, against the Bucs, because DJ Moore, of all people, he sprung to life. Are you buying the Moore renaissance?
Yeah, I'm not sure what that word. Renaissance sounds like something you can get at Applebee's.
Renaissance,
like,
Gardner?
Right, you know, renaissance. Or, you know, I think you mean renaissance, but, like, renaissance is like, oh, I need a plate of riblets with some renaissance on the side.
See,
is what
I want to say
for.
That we say renaissance in Australia, but I don't think we do. I think I just said it right.
I think you did. It's renaissance is the correct word. Yeah, some renaissance. Like, you know, can I get a demi-glaze and then renaissance on the side with my steak here at Applebee's. What I would say about DJ Moore, am I buying the renaissance of him? I guess somewhat. Like, you know, I mean, like, look, give credit where credit is due. So you sit here and you see it on your screen, right? Double-digit targets against the Buccaneers, but 7 targets against the Falcons, 8 against the Niners, 11 against the Cardinals. Like, the volume has been there. He finally put it all together. A big game here, 7 receptions, 69 yards, and a touchdown, 19.6 fantasy points. Give P.J. Walker credit. He played well in this game, right? And so, like, it helped that, Carlton Davis, that, you know, Bunting was out. Like, their secondary, the Buccaneers' secondary, was really beat up in this game. And so that certainly helped P.J. Walker. But they're at Atlanta next week. Speaking of injured secondaries, the Falcons are sort of beat up as well. And so I think he's, as long as he remains a wide receiver with the Panthers, as long as he has P.J. Walker under center, and they committed to him, you know, that it's hard to see, you know, Baker or Sam Darnold coming back and taking this job from him anytime soon. My expectation here is that he'll be that wide receiver 3. Like, he's still going to be in beer goggles on Sunday morning. Like,
yeah, he'll be a 4.
Right,
three or
yeah,
four
three or
week.
Four beers. Like, you're not going to be like, oh, yeah, I feel, you know, all is forgiven, DJ Moore. Like, but it was positive. Yep. Like, the volume was there, and we know the talent has never gone away.
I think the other thing with DJ Moore is that now the Panthers have three quarterbacks who realistically any of them could be starting 4 weeks from now in PJ Walker, Baker Mayfield, and Sam Darnold. And the pass game is largely just going to be tied to DJ Moore and how well DJ Moore is doing. And so I think that if someone is bad with DJ Moore, then they're probably out and you cycle the next guy in to help Moore reach his ceiling. Now, the Carolina running backs, it was a bit
They do have Atlanta twice in the next 3 weeks. So that, in theory, should help. I mean, we just saw what Cincinnati did to him last week.
Yep. So on Sunday. The two Carolina running backs, that was one of the big waiver stories between Foreman and Hubbard. Both deliver yesterday.
Yeah, I mean, we thought the answer was neither. Turns out the answer was either.
Yeah.
Was both. I said, look, I prefer Deontay Foreman to Chuba Hubbard, right? And so Foreman had the bigger day, 118 total yards on 15 rushes. He also was involved in the passing game, 2 for 27. Now, it's worth noting, basically half of his yardage came on one 60-yard run, but he has that big playability. Like, it's worth noting, but it's also worth noting, like, that's in his skill set. We've seen that before, and the Panthers know that as well. So they're going to continue to give him opportunities. Chuba Hubbard leaves this game with an injury, and after that, he went 11 for 48. So that was somewhat productive. I think it's going to continue to be a committee there. We'll see if Hubbard's injury is serious as well. It's worth noting about Chuba Hubbard, right? Through the first three quarters, he was actually out-snapping Foreman 22-14. He was a little bit more involved in the passing game here, but truly was kind of like basically split down the middle. And I still prefer Foreman just because I think week in, week out, he's going to have a better chance at a touchdown. He's a bigger back. He's a more bruising back. I think Hubbard, they're both involved in the passing game, but Foreman is somebody that I think will have more of the carries in close. It's like we said, they play Atlanta next week. Yep. Falcons are decent against the run, but
Not terrifying. Yep. Hubbard was named the starter, but I don't think that really matters. Like, it didn't really matter with Kansas City, who named Isaiah Pacheco the starter, but
you know what? And they didn't, though. I want to say this, because for people that missed fantasy football pregame on Sunday morning, we got a report that NFL Network was saying Isaiah Pacheco was the starter, and I didn't see the exact report. So if I'm mishandling, maybe they said he was getting first team reps. I don't know. But what I said on fantasy football pregame, and I will say there, is that you have to take those reports with a grain of salt. Specifically those, this player is starting that. Yep. Take it all with a grain of salt. What we said on pregame, what turned out to be right, which is we said, hey, we're still ranking CEH highest. This is still going to be a running back by committee that plays the hot hand. And the truth of the matter is that actually Jerick McKinnon is the guy that played the most snap. Isaiah Pacheco played only 30% of snaps. And honestly, most of that came in the fourth quarter when the game was out of hand and it was just sort of in clock killing mode. Clyde Edwards-Helaire plays 17 snaps, Pacheco 19 snaps. As we talked about, McKinnon, 28 snaps. He leads the team as they went sort of pass-heavy here. CEH gets you the touchdown. But ultimately, Jay, this is going to be a running back by committee where they play the hot hand, and I think ideally you don't want any of them. They're on a bye next week.
Yep. Last year, no Chiefs running back had more than 150 targets or 600 rushing yards. I feel like we're in for that again. But Mecole Hardman, he was the story. Three touchdowns. We thought that this Chiefs pass-catching group was going to be a nightmare. It's proving to be a nightmare week on, week out. But at the same time, if JuJu is producing and if Mecole wants to get his touchdowns on top of it, it may not matter. But are you buying Mecole Hardman going forward?
Absolutely not.
Okay. Sorry, Mecole. You're out.
I mean, just... he got three touchdowns on six touches.
Yeah.
Four receptions for 32 yards, two rushes for 28 yards, three touchdowns. One receiving, two rushing. Like six touchdowns. He got three touchdowns on six touches.
Yep.
Like, that's the Chiefs for you, right? You know, have yourself a day, Mecole Hardman, but can't imagine that ever repeating or ever starting him. Like, I just, you know, sell high if you can kind of thing here. But, like, he just... I don't know. Like, are you buying it in any way, shape, or form?
I'm not, but I might be buying JuJu Smith-Schuster, certainly more than last week, where last week seemed unsustainable. He had the big game, 113
yards. He had four targets. Mecole Hardman had four targets.
Yep. I wouldn't be rushing to pick
him up. In a game in which Patrick Mahomes threw the ball 34 times, he had four targets.
Yeah. No, I don't buy Mecole Hardman, but I do buy JuJu Smith-Schuster being a potentially low-end wide receiver two, high-end flex with what he's shown the past 2 weeks. Now, we thought last week was probably unsustainable with just the five targets. Gets eight targets this week. and goes 124 yards and a touchdown. It's now 5 of 7 games where he's had 8 targets.
Yeah, I mean, he had that 45-yard touchdown, which was great. I mean, like, just in a little bit of busted coverage, a great play by JuJu. And so what's nice is that we're seeing the average depth of target become a little bit longer here for JuJu. They're taking a little bit more shots downfield. You know, he had the 8 targets on this one that was tied for the most with Kelsey. That's encouraging, right? So 7 for 124, great. 8 targets, super encouraging as well. The other thing here is that he's now had back-to-back games with 100 yards and a touchdown. And so, interesting. They're on a bye next week, so not super interesting. But don't mind, like, if you're going through waivers, and, like, it's only the Chargers and Chiefs on waivers this week. And so if you're like, you know what, I'm good, and I'm just trying to fortify for sort of the stretch run, it feels like he's starting to become the JuJu that we thought he would become in the preseason, which is, if you're starting a pass catcher on the Chiefs not named Travis Kelce, who is it? We still think it's JuJu Smith-Schuster. And so if he was dropped in your league, he probably won't be a heavy pickup this week because they're on a bye. Maybe a guy to grab and stash.
Yep. Let's quickly just touch on Christian McCaffrey. I feel like we have to. Who's the big story of last week. He gets 8 carries, which is more than, honestly, I expected. I know our friend Michael Smith thought he was going to just be Christian McCaffrey again, but he did get a decent workload. He looked great when he was out there, but I think it's largely just as expected.
Yeah, 22 snaps here, but of the running back rushing share, 47%. They were a negative game script for much of this game, and that's not going to be the case for most of the 49ers games. They're going to be winning or close in most games. They play the Rams next week. I think if you have Christian McCaffrey on your roster, you wish you had a better box score from Sunday, but I think you should be thrilled.
Yep.
You should be thrilled because he's going to have a really big, you know, he's got a chance to be Ken Walker down the stretch.
Like, that's how good. Let's not get crazy
that's,
now. Let's
that's
not
how
get
good crazy. Christian McCaffrey
in front of the Big Apple. Let's not
could
get
be
crazy.
Like, oh yeah. You know what we should do is, you know what we should do is, we should paint like eyes, like sort of menacing eyes on, right? Exactly. It's
Halloween
supposed to be terrifying. So it's sort of always looking over me. Like, if I have a bad take or if I go a little bit too far, we can just cut to the
refer
apple.
To the eye.
And it's just kind of like, you know, like.
Okay.
It'd be great if we don't have the budget for this, but it'd be great if we actually had animated eyes. If, you know, if we said we said a surprising stat, you know, that kind of thing. Like, did you know Tom Brady has the, you know, losing record for the first time since 2002? And then you cut to the apple and it's like a whoop. You know, with the eyebrows raised and, like, you know, big bug eyes or, like, you know.
All right.
Right. Then I start making fun of, like you. And, like, then it gets, like, you know, the eyes go to, like, little slits, like angry eyes, you know, and that kind of stuff. Right.
All right. That's ridiculous.
You have young kids. You've seen Toy Story, right?
Yeah, I've seen
You
Toy
ever
Story.
See, like, the Mr. Potato Head,
yeah,
the Mr. Potato Head
yeah,
character?
Yeah, everything
like,
falls
where
off.
Are my angry eyes? Get my angry eyes?
Yeah.
That's what we need for the apple.
Yeah.
Like, just different eyes and, you know,
well,
expressions.
Let's cut to some happy eyes from Gus Edwards, who led the Ravens backfield yesterday.
Yes.
It was tough. It was up and down. I wanted to be back. I wanted to be back game one, but it doesn't always work like that. I was on God's timing. And it's a lot of season left. Like I said, I'm even fortunate to be playing right now with the type of injury I had. And I just got to keep building off of it.
So was it more than just an ACL?
Yeah, it was ACL, hamstring, LCL.
How do you feel physically coming out of this one, Gus?
I feel good, but I'm about to go get back in the tubs, though, and make sure.
Gus Edwards, 16 carries yesterday for 66 yards, 2 touchdowns. The Ravens ran the ball 44 times. They were treating Lamar Jackson like Zach Wilson, which I think bodes well if you're a Gus Edwards owner, because he's clearly the guy that you want in Baltimore's backfield.
I mean, he got more work in this game than I think J.K. Dobbins has gotten in his entire career.
Yeah.
More work than J.K. Dobbins has ever gotten. He got 36.5 for the Baltimore running back snap share in this one. And by the way, to the eye, looked like Gus Edwards.
Yeah,
looked like the Gus Bus, you know, north-south runner. It's his first game since week 16 of the 2020 season. Played 23 snaps in this. Got the bunny touchdown, right? I mean, his longest run was 12 yards. But that's what we think. He's going to grind it out. Like, and he clearly played ahead of Kenyon Drake, who was coming off of the big game, right? I mean, Kenyon Drake, 11 rushes for 5 yards. I mean, so
yeah,
it is.
It's not great.
And you think about the fact that, Dobbins is out 4 to 6 weeks here. He is going to be the leader of this backfield as well. They play, as we mentioned, they play the Buccaneers on Thursday night. So maybe still you'll see some Justice Hill and Kenyon Drake, because on the short week coming off the injury, they may not want to give him another full workload. And the two touchdowns, again, they got close, and some of those will be vultured by Lamar Jackson. But, yeah, if you manage to grab Gus Edwards, we've talked about him quite a bit. I think, hey, you just lucked into a RB2 yep. the rest of the way. More value in non-PPR than PPR. He got just one target, didn't come down with it. This one, he's not going to be involved in the passing game here. But we said this. This was a question we got asked on Fantasy Football Pregame. And just a reminder to people to join us on Sunday. We answer your questions a ton. We got a question. What am I doing with the Ravens backfield? And I said, I prefer Gus Edwards. To any of these guys, because I think he's got the best shot at a touchdown. Wound up with two in this one. Curious. For a game in which the Ravens won,
yeah.
Lamar Jackson and Mark Andrews were two of the bigger busts in this one.
Unsighted.
Yeah, I think Rashad Bateman got down to the 1 yard line. That would have been a touchdown pass for Lamar Jackson. Some sort of bad luck there. Mark Andrews only got two targets in this one. What one was a pass into the end zone, which he could have come down with. That's a touchdown. I'm willing to just say just bad day at the office for these two guys. Andrews was on the injury report this week, Jay, and, yep. and that may have affected things.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, and also, what are you going to do? Like, you got to start Lamar Jackson, Mark Andrews, and I think you can just write that off. They have enough of a resume.
It's worth noting, Lamar Jackson passed 16 times. Like, yeah. there were only 16 pass attempts in this game. Like, so, yeah, the whole thing was weird, but they, home game against a tough Browns defense, and they grinded out a win. Yep. Good for the Ravens.
They did. One team that didn't really need to grind it out was Cincinnati, and here's Ja'Marr Chase and T. Higgins talking about the big day for the wide receivers.
How aware were you guys how close you were to having three receivers on 100 yards?
Oh, we're super aware. I mean, T went out of bounds.
Good job, T.
All T fault.
I know you couldn't hear it. Ja'Marr looked over and said, good job, T, for going out of bounds when you had a chance to get... all three wide receivers with 100 yards. Your thoughts?
Man, first of all, I started cramping. So there was no point in me even trying to run. And then I got robbed and they said I was out of it. I didn't catch it when I did, but it's all right.
How are you guys aware of that? Who tells you those numbers?
You can see it on the board at the top. Yeah, so.
Would that have been cool? All three?
Definitely would have been cool. We always talk about it, man. That's something we want to accomplish. And I think today was the closest we ever got. And so we know we can get it. So, I mean, we just got to keep it going and try another game.
There you go. Talking about that, the first voice you heard was Ja'Marr Chase. Second voice, T. Higgins, talk about the fact that they want to get all three wide receivers along with Tyler Boyd to each have a 100-yard game. They were giving T a little bit of crap. You should have seen T. I wish for people listening at home, you should have seen T's facial expression. He rolled his eyes.
So good.
Again, that would have been good if we had the apple. If we had the eyes on the apple, the apple also could have rolled his eyes here. The fact of the matter is, they had awesome games. Ja'Marr Chase and T. Higgins are locked in as wide receiver ones. Joe Burrow, just a monster game for him. 481, three touchdowns. He also runs for one as well. Just monster games, and they play at Cleveland next week on the Monday night game. I guess for me, the only question out of this game is, like, great, they're doing what you drafted them to be. They're fantasy superstars. Is Tyler Boyd 8 for 155 and a touchdown, second most routes against the Bengals wide receivers? He ran a route on over 80% of his snaps. We buying this for Tyler Boyd, or how much do you think is this just like, hey, they were killing the Falcons. He had the one big play as well. Can you count on Tyler Boyd, Jay, moving forward?
I mean, the previous 5 weeks, he didn't have more than six targets in a game. You're not going to get as kind matchups as Atlanta most weeks. And I still think we are going to ultimately see some regression back to Zach Taylor just running Joe Mixon a million times, because that's what he wants to do deep down in his heart. But look, they have huge upside. This is the second time Tyler Boyd has broken 100 yards. Like, I think you can definitely do worse in your flex spots week to week, but I don't think he's going to sniff being a wide receiver too.
Yeah, I mean, like, he had the 60-yard touchdown to jump it off, but then, so you're like, okay, so, one big play, whatever. But guy still had almost 100 yards after that. He had, he had 7 for 100 after that 60-yard touchdown. So just a monster day at the office for Tyler Boyd. Don't mind him in deeper leagues, but I agree with you. I think he is still, on a week-to-week basis, more of a risky wide receiver for wide receiver three, somewhere in that range, where there's some upside, but again, we haven't seen the consistent production. Remember, four out of the seven games this year, he's been under 50 yards receiving. There's more variance with Tyler Boyd than there is with Higgins or Chase.
Yep. All right, let's go to the other side. Kyle Pitts and Drake London. Now, here's the way I look at this, Matthew.
I need angry eyes, Apple.
Do you know the film Drive with Ryan Gosling? So the protagonist, Ryan Gosling's protagonist basically just doesn't.
Yeah, you can ruin this one for me. I'm not going to see it.
The protagonist just doesn't speak. Gosling, he barely ever talks, but it kind of works and it's in the flow. Drive?
Drive, no.
Yeah.
So I don't think I've seen any Ryan Gosling movie.
Wow,
so
you're denying yourself. He's a good actor. Anyway, he barely ever speaks, but it works. And then the next film.
Is he a superhero? Then I'm not seeing it.
No,
okay, there you go.
He's not a superhero. The next film that he does with this director, Nicholas Winding Refn, is called Only God Forgives, which is terrible. And in that film, he just doesn't speak at all.
But it's
like he's having a contest not to ever speak. It's not actually in the flow of anything.
If he's such a good actor, why doesn't he talk? Maybe he's the Zach Wilson of movies.
He talks with his eyes.
Maybe he's the Zach Wilson of movies, where they're just trying to hide him.
No one's trying to hide Ryan Gosling. But here's my thing with Arthur Smith.
Yes, sir.
First 6 weeks, it's like the Gosling and Drive. Not talking, but it's working. This week, not talking, not throwing the ball, just for the sake of it, as if he's doing a bit. Marcus Mariota just never throws the ball, despite the fact that they're down multiple touchdowns the whole game, which makes me think maybe there is no hope for Kyle Pitts or Drake London.
They trailed 21-0 after the first quarter, and on the 45 total plays that were called, they had 16 dropbacks. They were down three touchdowns.
Yep.
And still, Marcus Mariota had 13 pass attempts in this game. Damn, Arthur Smith is going to establish the run, damn it. He's going to establish it. Oh, I don't care. Like, what? Listen, here's the thing. So, Kyle Pitts, I'm not dropping him because it's the talent is massive and it's so brutal at tight end. But he's no longer a must start. I think it depends on the matchup, by the way. And you don't love the matchup with a suddenly red hot Carolina Panthers defense coming up next week. I think Drake London is welcome to Dumpsville. Because the argument there's no question about his talent. We're not questioning his talent. But the argument for Drake is, even though off the last week, he's still getting volume. He had one reception for 9 yards in this game. I mean, he had, I think, two targets. Let me check. He had one target. They're throwing it 13 times a game, and they got their asses kicked here.
It's not like
before we kept talking about the fact that they 6-0 against covering the spread. Well, now they're 6-1, right?
They got
destroyed by the Bengals in this game, and yet still down big, and they still wouldn't let Marcus Mariota throw. His lowest target share of the season, 9%. I mean, maybe they go back to the drawing board, but I don't know.
Okay.
If I saw Drake, let me put it this way, and then we can move on. If I saw Drake London on my waiver wire in anything other than the deepest of leagues, I'm ignoring him.
Yep. No, I think that's fair. All right, quickly, before we go to break, let's talk Aaron Rodgers, who again just did nothing.
Yeah, he ran into the buzzsaw that is the Commanders. Hail the Commanders, hail victory.
Yeah, the Commanders. Unbelievable.
If I had a Taylor Heineke jersey, I would wear it.
Because it's Taylor Heineke. He looked like the better quarterback at times against Aaron Rodgers.
He's 1-0.
I'd rather have Geno Smith going forward than Aaron Rodgers. I'd rather have Derek Carr than Eric. Derek Carr, Aaron Rodgers are pretty close. Kirk Cousins, rather have him than Aaron Rodgers.
I think you could make an argument. I'm not saying this, but I think you could make an argument that you'd rather have Taylor Heineke for the next 4 or 5 weeks. Listen, it won't be pretty with Heineke, but he runs around a little bit. They're going to have to force the ball. I don't know what's going on. Think about this. Aaron Rodgers next week at Buffalo, just like us.
Yeah.
Fantasy Football Pregame will be live in Buffalo. If you are in the Buffalo area, come on out and hang out with us in the parking lot of Bills Stadium Sunday morning as we'll do Fantasy Football Pregame. And then that night, of course, Packers at Bills Sunday Night Football right here on NBC and Peacock. I'm a company man. But look at their upcoming schedule. At Buffalo, at Detroit, home to Dallas versus Tennessee. The only one you feel good about is at Detroit.
Yep.
This should have been a good matchup for him against the Commanders.
There are no good matchups for Aaron Rodgers right now and that passing offense. It's just a complete mess. And he is an 11.5-point underdog to Buffalo next week.
Hey, it's Matthew Berry from NBC Sports and RotoWorld.com. Just want to thank you so much for watching what you just watched, or at least being too lazy to click out of it after the autoplay just kept it going. So either way, thank you so much for just letting it scroll by your screen. And now I'd like to ask you respectfully, please, subscribe to the NFL on NBC YouTube channel for the latest NFL news, fantasy headlines from RotoWorld, and betting analysis from NBC Sports Edge.